100 kilometers in length, the Crowsnest Pass is the lowest of three valleys which slice through the Rocky Mountains and straddle the provinces of British Columbia and Alberta. It is a peaceful place, but its quiet beauty hides scars that cut deep into the hearts and memories of those who call the Crowsnest home, those who know what it means to be living on the edge. In 1873, prospector Michael Phillips is the first European to cross the pass, camping at the site that would one day be the town of Fernie, BC.
We found trees covered with buffalo hair, and it was evident that we had passed through the Rocky Mountains without going over any ranges. We could find nothing but coal everywhere.
With the arrival of the railway, the Crowsnest becomes one of the largest coal-producing areas in Canada. By 1901, production is as high as 1,400 tons a day. The Crowsnest is booming, towns are growing, and more families are calling the valley their home. With an eye to the future, they forget to heed a warning from the past. There is an ancient native legend in the Crowsnest that surrounds one mountain range in particular, named for its resemblance to a giant turtle.
The natives that traveled through the Crowsnest Valley were mostly the Kootenai and the Blackfoot, and although they came through this area quite often doing their seasonal hunting and fishing, they would not camp in the valley at the base of Turtle Mountain. And they had a name for the mountain that meant the mountain that moves slowly.
As native hunters roam the passes of Turtle Mountain, they notice huge fissures at its summit, cracks in the turtle's back that are gradually getting larger. While it is enough to keep First Nations away from the mountain's shadow, it does not prevent the town of Frank from being built there.
Largely immigrants came to the Crowsnest Pass in general, including Frank, to work in the coal mines. So you had people from all over Europe, Ukraine, Russia, Poland. You had people from Wales with the coal mining background. You had also people from Eastern Canada and the United States coming to work here.
By 1901, the population of Frank is 300. By 1903, that number has doubled, and the future looks bright. The mine near the town is one of the top producers in the pass. It's said that the town of Frank may one day rival Pittsburgh. The first business in Frank is the mercantile store built by Alex Leach, originally from Quebec. With his wife Rosemary and their seven children, Alex lives in one of a row of coal company cottages on Alberta Avenue on the southeastern flats. Their neighbors are mostly mining families. The fathers work in the mine, while other family members work within the community of Frank itself. Miner Alfred Clark lives there with his wife and seven children. Oldest daughter Lillian works at the boarding house for single miners in the main town site. Meters above them stands Turtle Mountain. The people of Frank have often compared it to a giant sentinel guarding their destinies. For some, it will soon seal their fate.
Turtle Mountain is what's called an anticline. It's bent over in top, and it's made up of layers of rock that were weakened because when they anticline formed, they slid one against the other. So there were inherent natural planes of weakness.
As the mountain forms, a fault line under the anticline causes some rock layers to crack and separate. It pushes older limestone deposits up and over softer layers of sandstone, shale, and coal. Millions of years of erosion eat away at the mountain's soft base. Limestone layers above form a ledge that grows steeper as the years pass. By spring of 1903, coal mining has dug away another 1,500 meters at the base. Turtle Mountain is a disaster waiting to happen. April 28th, 1903. Just another day in the town of Frank. In the last 7 months, there has been movement in the mine, like a ship hit by a wave. Rocks have fallen and timbers have cracked, but today, miners working the day shift finish without incident. Young Bob Chestnut has only been in town for 10 days, and a miner for 9 of them.
It was a bright afternoon, bright sunshine, and you could look up there and you could see the snow. And there was little pings of rock coming down. And some of those little pieces of rock would hit the tipple, come right down and bang on the railers like that, you know. Well, I didn't think anything about it. The fellows didn't, the miners didn't. I said, oh, well, that happens in the springtime.
As Bob Chestnut and his brother return to their room at the Union Hotel, Alex Leach closes his store, looking forward to a quiet evening with his family. At a construction camp east of town, manager John McVeigh settles in for the night. He usually goes home to the neighboring town of Blairmore, but his wife is visiting relatives in Calgary, so he decides to stay in camp. At the Leach house, it's time for the children to go to bed. Jesse Leach comes downstairs.
My mother was sitting beside a table sewing. Across from her sat my father reading. I kissed them and said goodnight. I never saw them again.
Across town, 15-year-old Lillian Clark is finishing her chores at the boarding house.
She went to bed late after working late in the dining room and the kitchen at the single miner's boarding house. She had a room there of her own and she slept there. And that was the first time she ever did. It was the first time in her life she slept anywhere but at home.
At midnight, 20 miners working the night shift arrive at the mine entrance. It's their job to maintain the tunnels and equipment for the day shift. Lillian's father, Alex Clark, is there, and so is Charlie Ellick, who emigrated to Frank from Austria 2 years earlier. Not long after the miners go underground, a freight train arrives to pick up coal cars. The engineer is in no rush. The passenger train out of Spokane is late again, and he has to wait on the spur line to let it through. At 4 a.m, most of the town of Frank is asleep. 17 miners are underground. Alex Clark and another miner have come to the surface with a load of coal. They stop to take their lunch break with the weighman who sorts coal at the tipple. High above them, on the summit of the giant turtle, the mountain that moves is about to live up to its name.
We know that it had been warm the day before. There had been a fairly heavy snowpack on top of the mountain, and that night the temperature dropped down to zero Fahrenheit.
When the temperature dropped, that water probably froze, expanded, and acted as kind of like a hand to push that rock over the edge.
The engineer heard some noise above him in the darkness and was excited by it, called to the brakeman to hop on, let's get out of here.
He guns the train, basically, puts it full speed ahead, and he's able to cross the Gold Creek Bridge, which is the dividing line, basically, between safety and death.
The train crew looks back as 82 million tons of rock scream down the mountainside. The avalanche erases everything in its path, including the bridge the train cleared just seconds before. Alex Clark and the two other miners try to run. The train crew watches as the rock slide sweeps over the men, then buries the mine entrance and tipple. In her room at the boarding house, Lillian Clark wakes up to the roar of rock pounding across the valley floor.
I'm sure she didn't know what it was. I heard stories. People could look outside to see what was going on, and there was fog out there. It turned out it wasn't fog, it was dust from the rocks.
At the Union Hotel, Bob Chestnut hears a noise that reminds him of steam escaping under intense pressure.
And we were about 200 yards from the CPR tracks. And when this slide happened, I woke up and I said, gosh, that's a long freight going by. And we said, that's not a freight.
The giant wall of falling limestone creates a hurricane of air that rushes ahead of it, tearing up everything in its path. One giant finger of rock spreads eastward. It buries the cemetery, several farms, and the 16 men asleep in John McVeigh's construction camp. John McVeigh is one of them. Another splinter hits the banks of Gold Creek. It sends a wall of mud and rock towards the cottages on the other side. The mountain has waited millions of years to fall. It is over in a matter of 100 seconds. April 29th, 1903, 4:20 a.m. Clouds of gray dust obscure the landscape, which has changed completely in a matter of seconds.
Slide crossed the valley, scooping up river, rocks, and trees, and carrying them a distance of about a mile and a half up the opposite side, and piling debris in places to a depth of 100 feet in the valley, and spreading out east and west, a distance of about 2 miles. Northwest Mounted Police Report, 1904.
I think the block, when it left the top of Turtle Mountain, was a pretty solid piece of rock. It went down along one of these bedding planes and hit a projecting shelf about two-thirds of the way down the side of the mountains, and was launched into the air, trapped the air underneath it, compressed it. Even badly shattered rock material can be supported for a time on a layer of compressed air, which accounts for how far rock can move under these circumstances.
On Alberta Avenue, where the edge of the slide had swept through our town, the sight that met those who quickly went to the rescue was more than heartrending. Here, where the evening before, six families had retired to rest, but one was left intact. Frank said.
The Bansemer House is the only one left standing. It has been pushed some 20 feet from its foundation. The Bansemers are unharmed, but the fate of their neighbors is still unclear.
On arriving at the scene of the fire, we heard a man calling for help. Some of our party went to his assistance, finding that his house had been wrecked, and that the man, his wife, and a baby, and three other children had been caught in the wreck. George Bond, rescuer.
The man is Sam Ennis. He has managed to free himself from the rubble and is trying to do the same for his wife, Lucy. She is trapped in a sea of mud with their baby daughter, Gladys.
Mrs. Ennis reaches around in this mud with her hand that still she's able to use and discovers this baby, pulls little Gladys toward her, looks at the child and discovers that little Gladys is turning a funny shade of blue, obviously can't breathe, so Mrs. Ennis reaches inside the baby's throat, pulls out a whole bunch of mud, and saves her life.
Digging through the rubble, rescuers find the older Ennis children and their uncle all miraculously alive. Lester Johnson is also found. The last thing he hears when the slide hits is the dying screams of his parents, Charles and Ida Aykroyd.
When the slide stops, he finds himself between two large boulders, and piercing his side is a piece of wood, and it had pierced through a feather quilt into his side. And later on, the doctor pulled this out and discovered a whole bunch of feathers in his wound that had to be plucked out just like a chicken.
By now, dawn is breaking. Attention turns to the home of Alex Leach. It has been sheared completely in two. The top half has been carried by the slide to the banks of Gold Creek. Rescuers find little Jesse and May Leach pinned on the bed inside.
You've got two girls basically buried in the rubble, still alive. They were sound asleep when it occurred. So they're still in their 90s, and they can hear men, people walking above them, on top of them, basically.
They worked above us with pick and shovel, calling members of the family by name, lifting the beams and broken timbers. Finally, the terrific weight above us was lifted, and it was broad daylight. Someone held a tin cup to my lips, and a kindly voice said, "Try and drink this." I tried, but I choked. It was whiskey and water.
Further digging unearths the bottom portion of the house. Rescuers find the bodies of Alex and Rosemary Leach and two of their sons.
There were two boys sleeping in the back bedroom, and all the mud and stuff from this creek came pouring in through the back door and bedroom. The older one was sleeping at the back of the bed. We found him, not then, but a couple of days afterwards, stretched full length, and the younger one, like boys do, curious, he got up and was apparently looking out this back window on his hands and knees, and of course he crashed down.
The bodies of the other two boys are found the following day. fate has other plans for their baby sister.
A little baby is found out on the rocks, little Marion Leach. Some say she was found on a pile of hay. Others say she was underneath the eave of a house. Others say she was just out on the rocks, all by herself, but still alive, and she was only 18 months old.
With the morning light, Lillian Clark returns from the boarding house to the place where she lived with her parents and six brothers and sisters. The cottage owned by Alex Clark has vanished completely. Lillian is the sole survivor.
She saw a whole bunch of rocks covering up the place where her home had been. There was nothing to see as far as the house was concerned. It was just all rocks there instead of the house. It must have been a tremendous blow. It must have been annihilating. Everything that she had was gone like that.
Rescue efforts continue under the afternoon sun. Trains evacuate women and children and bring medical personnel and reinforcements for rescue and cleanup. Included is a construction crew of 130 men. They were supposed to have stayed at John McVeigh's construction camp the previous evening.
They were scheduled to have arrived that night before the slide, but their train missed them. They were left on a blind siding near Morrissey, BC, and they were furious. Goodness, we have to wait for the next train. We're stuck here for the night. We're supposed to be there. But I'm sure they were very glad the next day to have had that occur.
As the day wears on, hope is dwindling for the 17 miners buried underground. The mine entrance is covered with rock and water. Search parties can only guess at its location. Underground, all 17 miners are alive, but time is running out.
There was some movement of coal in the mine, but no major collapse of the main workings. They assumed something had happened, so they started toward the entrance, found it was completely buried in debris.
They went to a lower area of the mine, to a second entrance, and discovered this rushing wall of water coming into the coal mine. Where was this water coming from? Well, it was coming from the Crowsnest River, which had been dammed up at the base of Turtle Mountain.
With boulders blocking one exit and water blocking another, several miners investigate an air shaft as a possible escape route. They return with bad news. The shaft is completely sealed. Lethal coal gas is accumulating at dangerous levels. Their oxygen supply is running out. Throughout the day, Turtle Mountain continues to belch rock on rescue workers trying to find the entrance to the Frank mine. Somewhere beneath them, 17 miners try desperately to dig their way through broken rock and crushed timber. It's no use. Some begin to panic, but one sees another way out.
He decided that they could dig their way out through a coal seam. Coal is softer than limestone, so he thought this was a realistic possibility. They took turns digging through the seam of coal that outcropped on the surface.
The men work in relays of twos and threes. At first, they sing to boost their spirits. By late afternoon, they work silently, trying to conserve what little air they have left.
At about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, a figure was seen emerging from amongst the broken up rock in the mountain, a short distance above the rescue party. He was followed by others, and then the people realized that these men emerging from the depth of the mountain were the imprisoned miners who had dug themselves out of their prison to light and safety. Frank Sentinel.
The miners are escorted back to town, where details of the slide bring good news and bad. Charlie Ellick is reunited with his wife and children, all of whom have survived. For injured miner William Warrington, the news is tragic. His wife and three children are dead.
It's ironic that the miners survived this disaster. Many people in the community did not. It was wives and children largely who were killed.
There's approximately 100 people who were in the path of the 1903 Frank slide out of the 600 who lived in the town of Frank. Out of that 100 people, 23 of them survived, and most of those people came from a row of eight miners' cottages that were just caught on the eastern side of the Frank slide.
Less than 3 weeks after the slide, rail traffic resumes on the reconstructed CPR line. The mine reopens several weeks later. Soon it's back in full production. But the town of Frank will never be the same.
In 1912, an order was given by the government at the time that said all homes must now move. The North Peak was unstable and was in danger of sliding on the remaining town. So you see photographs of people loading their houses up and pulling these homes on wagons with horses pulling across the road to the present site of Frank.
In the years that follow, road improvements near the town site unearth several grim mementos. One is the remains of a house, the ceiling crushed to within a foot of the floor. Several skeletons are dug up, including a small one in a cradle. The family that Lillian Clark lost that day in April are finally found.
And the report is that they buried them at a place there alongside of the road that was being built, and there was a concrete marker that was placed there. And if these kids had lived, they would have been my aunts and uncles, and their children would have been my cousins, and I really felt a great deal of loss, because now I see that there was a whole group of Clarks on that side that would have enriched the family and made it much larger and much more interesting. I wish I hadn't known them.
As terrible as it was, the Frank slide is not the end of tragedy in the Crowsnest Pass. An even greater disaster is yet to come. By 1914, mining is the lifeblood of the Crowsnest. The Hillcrest Mine is considered the safest in the pass. By June of 1914, there are 377 men on the payroll and 1,000 people living in this close-knit community.
The men that worked in the underground mine at Hillcrest came from all over the place, down in from Eastern Canada. They were hometown boys from the communities around the Crowsnest Pass area, some men from the United States. They had traveled to Canada looking for a better future. They came from a lot of countries that were impoverished. They didn't have much chance. They'd lost their homes, their farms, so they came to Canada looking for a new life. Coal mining itself usually took place during the day shift. Most of the men that worked in the evening shifts were doing repairs, fixing the timbers that braced the walls of the mine, just checking and making sure everything was safe.
That's exactly what fire boss Daniel Briscoe is doing on the evening of June 18th, 1914. He finds an accumulation of methane gas and coal dust in several sections of the mine. Ventilation is good, however, with enough moisture to reduce the danger of explosion. Word is sent to the miners to be ready for work the following morning.
At that time, the Hillcrest mine had been closed down for 2 days, the Wednesday and Thursday before, because they'd overproduced. And so most of the men had had a couple of days off, which were nice for them. They were just heading back to work on the Friday morning at about 7 a.m. There was about 237 men that were scheduled to work underground that day.
David Murray is there that morning, proud to be working alongside his three sons. John Davison and his teenage son, John Jr., joined the group as well. After emigrating from England, John Sr. worked the Spring Hill mine before moving west to Hillcrest.
My grandfather started he was mining in the old country, and my dad lost his older brother in the collieries over there in a mine accident. And before they come out to this country, and then when they come out here, my grandfather, he carried on with mining. My dad started in the mines as he used to pump air up the slant to where the miners were working.
Charlie Ellick is there too. 11 years earlier, he was one of the 17 miners trapped by the Frank Slide. Not long after, he moved to Hillcrest because of the mine's good reputation. His wife is expecting the birth of their third child any day now.
Most of the men that were working there were fairly young. The oldest man that day was only 54. And in between, most of the men were early 20s, late 20s.
By 6:45 that morning, the men are approaching the lower level of Hillcrest Mine. Those working above ground go to their workstations. The rest check in with timekeeper Robert Hood. Each man is assigned two numbered brass tags that identify him in case of an accident. One he keeps with him. The other hangs on a pegboard in the timekeeper's office. Hillcrest consists of two mines. A 365-meter slant takes miners to the tunnels of mine number one. To the south, the slant for mine number two descends some 730 meters underground. It is linked to slant number one by two intersecting tunnels, levels one and two south. The third main section is level one north. Just after seven, the superintendent is the first to enter the mine. He is followed by a team of brattismen. It is their job to maintain the flow of air through the shafts. Giant fans at the two entrances move air through tunnels and passageways. None of the miners wear oxygen masks, so the fans are vital to their safety. Once the mine is deemed safe, the superintendent gives the go-ahead. The miners follow him in. John Davison and his son arrive at the same shaft, but split up to work in different areas.
When they went into the mine, my grandfather went to the left down this other shaft, and my dad went farther down into the mines and over to the right and over towards the number two shaft.
8 a.m. Fire boss Sam Charlton sets off a number of charges near Slant 1 to expand the tunnels leading deeper into the mine. Married less than a month, he takes no chances. When he's not setting charges, he keeps his battery and firing cable in separate places. 9 a.m. Eight more miners check in at the timekeeper's office, but two are turned away.
Robert Hood smelled alcohol on their breath, and he wouldn't let them go underground. Now, little did they realize that by stopping and having a few shots of whiskey in the morning, they were going to save their lives that day.
In the town below, it's time for school. Most of the children hurrying to class have fathers, brothers, or uncles who are now deep inside the mountain. 9:30 a.m. 235 men are below ground. Sam Charlton prepares charges in Tunnel 32. Engineer Alex May has just inspected the giant electric intake fan at the mouth of Hillcrest Number 1. He is on his way to inspect the steam-driven exhaust fan at mine number 2. As Alex May gets to his feet, he sees brown smoke pouring from the ventilation shaft. The intake fan is no longer moving.
They knew from working underground for years and years and years that what was going to happen after that initial blast was that the fire was going to eat up all the oxygen inside the mine and leave behind what the men refer to as afterdamp, which is a deadly mixture of carbon dioxide and carbon monoxide that would kill a man quite quickly if he was left underground.
The entrance to mine number 1 is a mass of fallen rock, broken timbers, and demolished mine cars. There is no way in and no way out. The mine whistle begins to blow. As the whistle of the Hillcrest mine roars through the surrounding valley, desperate family members come running.
The families that were left behind in the town of Hillcrest would know immediately what was going on when they heard the mine whistle blowing the way they did. And they could see the brown smoke cloud moving up into the air from the town site as well.
It was just bedlam when this explosion happened, and that everybody, wives and mothers, raced up to the mine entrance to see if there was their sons, their husbands, their fathers were safe.
In the terrifying darkness, John Davison Jr. searches for a way out.
Two men that were with my dad, two miners that had been picking coal while he was pumping air, they come along and they had to crawl on their hands and knees, holding onto a railway track because they couldn't see it. Everything was out, lamps and everything were all out.
Within 20 minutes of the blast, 16 miners make it to the surface. 16 out of 235. One of them is David Murray, frantically searching the blackened faces of the men beside him.
He realized that none of his three sons were there. At that time, he panicked and he turned to go back in the mine. When the mounted police tried to stop him, he was in such a panic because none of his sons had made it, that he fought them off and he ran back into the mine entrance, and he actually did not survive the Hillcrest mine disaster.
It is just after 10 a.m. An emergency hospital is set up in the mine yard. Oxygen masks arrive and are sent down to rescue crews. Outside, the waiting crowd is close to panic. With oxygen masks, search parties probe deeper into the mine, but rescue attempts are hit and miss. Rescue workers are able to send a group of miners from Level 1 North safely to the surface. One of them is young John Davison, but not the John Davison everyone expects.
They walked all the way from the number 2 mine entrance down to the number 1 mine entrance. And the report was that my dad had been killed. But when they got down there, then they found out it was my grandfather that was killed.
Confused by the smoke and the complicated maze of passageways, surviving miners arrive at the entrance to mine number one. They find it hopelessly blocked. They turn and head back toward the other entrance. The afterdamp hunts them down one by one. By now, only 26 bodies have been recovered. One of them is David Murray, overcome by lethal gases while searching for his sons. None of his boys will make it out alive.
By 12 o'clock on that day, Friday, all of the men who were going to live from the Hillcrest mine disaster had gotten out. And after that, it seemed to be a strange calm that fell across the people that were on the outside of the mine. They realized at that time that the chances of seeing their loved ones come up from under the mine alive were very slim.
When rescue workers finally punch a hole into mine number one, they find a grim picture of death and destruction. Bodies burned and disfigured beyond recognition, others frozen in a final death pose. So many more relentlessly pursued, then choked to death by the black damp. Sunday, June 21st, 1914, is uncharacteristically cold for early summer. Snow falls on the grim procession that carries wooden coffins to the Hillcrest Cemetery. John Davidson Sr. is one of the dead, and so is Charlie Ellick, the Frank Slide survivor whose luck has finally run out.
Well, I was born the next day after the explosion. When they brought all them bodies out, my mother couldn't even recognize them. They were all burnt. My stepfather bought this monument to him and placed it on in the grave somewhere. They didn't know if it was on his body or who, but.
Charles's family was not very lucky when it came to Hillcrest. His wife had her baby the day after the Hillcrest mine disaster.
We lived in a tent, three girls and two boys. And I was in bed with my mother, and then the big storm come up, a windstorm, and there was a big fir tree just beside the tent. And it blew over and fell, just missed me and my mother in bed.
So in 2 days, Mrs. Ellick buried her husband, had a baby, and lost her home.
There wasn't a family that was untouched. You know, there was always somebody lost a son or a father or a husband. But it was a really bad time to hear my dad explain it anyway.
Ethel's own father is saved by fate that morning at Hillcrest. He had been scheduled to work the day shift.
But his friend called him and asked him to change shifts because his friend's wife was coming in later that afternoon and he wanted to meet her at the train.
So my dad changed with him, and this man was in the explosion and saved my dad's life because of his change.
Out of the 235 men that went underground in the coal mine that day, only 46 of them got out of the mine alive, so 189 men in all were killed in the Hillcrest mine disaster, making it the worst mine disaster in Canada's history.
The cause of the explosion is uncertain. Some put it down to a spark from a miner's pick, a faulty lamp, or inadequate safety standards. It remains a mystery to this day. Today, the communities of Frank and Hillcrest still survive, but not as they once did. Now they are part of the municipality of Crowsnest Pass, an amalgamation of several mining towns in the area. In Hillcrest, the cemetery that marks one of Canada's greatest tragedies has been designated an historic site. An interpretive center now overlooks the 3-kilometer stretch of the Frank Slide. The scar of fallen rock is testament to the tumultuous history of the Crowsnest Pass. The site of the original town is an industrial park. Like its predecessor, it lives in the shadow of Turtle Mountain.
There's no guarantee that we'll be able to tell if it will slide again. It's possible that the mountain will give us no warning. It's possible that she will hold still forever, that there will be no other slide from this mountain, and another mountain will surprise us. So that's what I would say would be the legacy of the Frank Slide, is really the power of nature, the surprises that she holds.